Announcing the arrival of the UMC and respected guests. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand to sing the national anthem Negaraku, followed by the IIUM song. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Praise be to Allah, the cherisher and sustainer of the world, and blessings be on our Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his family and his companions. Honorable Professor Dr. Ahmad Faris bin Ismail, Acting Rector and Deputy Rector of Academic and Internationalization. Honorable Professor Dr. Amir Akramin bin Shafi'i, the Deputy Rector of Responsible Research and Innovation. Honorable Professor Dr. Shukran bin Abdul Rahman, Dean of Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman, Kuliah of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Sciences. Honorable Professor Dr. Rahmah binti Ahmad Haji Osman, Honorable Professor Dr. Asim Shahadeh Saleh Ali. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and a very good morning. Welcome to the inaugural professorial lecture. On behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to bid welcome, ahlan wa sahlan, to everyone present in this glorious hall this morning. First and foremost, we would like to extend our heartfelt gratitude to Professor Dr. Ahmad Faris for being here with us. For your information, this inaugural professorial lecture is organized by Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman Kuliah of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Sciences to allow the professors to introduce and expound upon their existing body of work and their current research in their specialized fields. This lecture is also to celebrate the professors' achievements and provide a platform for engagement with our audience today. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to invoke the blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will begin the ceremony with Quranic recitation by Assistant Professor Dr. Muhammad Anwar bin Ahmad. Tafadhal.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فافسحوا يفسح الله لكم وإذا قيل انشزوا فانشزوا يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات والله بما تعملون خبير يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا ناجيتم الرسول فقدموا بين يدي نجواكم صدقة ذلك خير لكم وأطهر فإن لم تجدوا فإن الله غفور فإن الله غفور رحيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. والشعراء يتبعهم الغاوون. ألم تر أنهم في كل واد يهيمون وأنهم يقولون ما لا يفعلون. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وذكروا الله كثيرا وانتصروا من بعد ما ظلموا، وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. صدق الله العظيم.
Shukran, Doctor. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I now have the pleasure to respectfully invite Professor Dr. Ahmad Faris bin Ismail to deliver the opening speech.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. الحمد لله رب العالمين. Praise be to Allah سبحانه وتعالى for allowing us to gather here this morning for a very important session. I would like to congratulate the Kuliah for organizing this inaugural professorial lecture for 2024. So let me first, on behalf of the university, welcome our distinguished guests. I mean, we see Tan Sri, Datuk, Datuk, and with us this morning. And of course, my colleague, Prof. Shukran, and my colleague, Prof. Amir, and Kuliah's leaders. But the most important thing is our two speakers for today's event. We have our Professor Dr. Asim Shahadah Saleh Ali and Professor Dr. Rahmah Ahmad Osman. So, brothers and sisters, I mean, I would like to again thank the Kuliah for organizing this very important event. As a university, we would like to promote more scholarly programs, activity, intellectual discourse. So we hope that, alhamdulillah, we just completed our semester. So this is a good time for us to reflect on the last academic year, planning for the coming academic year. And I think it is very important to put in our Kuliah's calendar the scholarly activity. So I would like, again, to, like yesterday I was at Kuliah of Education. I mentioned at the Kuliah of Education that if possible, I mean, this is a Kuliah University event, but I think we also would like to promote scholarly intellectual discourse at even the departmental level. I mean, so I think each department, I mean, should regenerate, re-energize this intellectual, environment. I mean, because we are a university. So my rough calculation, if you have 12 people in the department, you can say that every month, one professor, one lecturer take one slot and present your ideas, present your research, present your solutions, and then you can have a good discussion, exchange of ideas, brainstorming session, so that we can get a very, I mean, good results in our research, as well as providing solutions to the Ummah and to the country. Alhamdulillah, I mean, over the years, the Department of Arabic Language and Literature has significantly advanced the study of the Arabic language in non-Arabic speaking environment. Alhamdulillah, I mean, I should mention that when we interviewed a few candidates from your department to become our lecturers and teachers, I mean, we were pleasantly surprised to see their competency in Arabic. So sometimes we wonder, where did you learn your Arabic? They say, wow, at the RUM. So alhamdulillah, we are very proud of that. Keep the good work. So since its establishment, the department has nurtured thousands of undergraduate and postgraduate students, undertaken substantial and impactful research, and produced credible scholars in the field. It has become one of the most sought-after and favored departments among students wishing to specialize in Arabic language and literature. So I believe that the department, inshallah, is one of the best in the country, if not in the region, offering Arabic language studies. Alhamdulillah, this morning, we are privileged to receive insightful lectures from our esteemed speakers, one an expert in linguistics and the other in literature. Professor Dr. Asim Shahadah Saleh Ali will present on the phenomena of Islamization in the ancient linguistic heritage in light of modern linguistics. I look forward to Professor Asim's discussion on how Islam influenced ancient languages and linguistic traditions, particularly Arabic. It is intriguing that he will be exploring these influences using modern approaches. And Professor Dr. Rahmah Ahmad Osman will offer her lecture on divine inspiration, poetic expression, exploring the intersection of theology and poetry in the works of the ulama. So I look forward for her, speech, and expect that she will explore how the ulama use poetry to convey their theological ideas in their writings. I am eager to listen from both of them, okay? And I think this also should inspire the rest of us on to continue working on this Islamization, integration, as well as relevantization research, which is the vision and mission of the university. So we extend our congratulations and gratitude to the professors for sharing their scholarly work with us this morning. And hopefully these lectures will elevate the standard of Arabic scholarship, as both professors have illustrated the connection between Arabic language and humanities studies by integrating concept of Islamization and relevantization into their research. And indeed, I think if I remember the beginning of Kuliah of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Science, I'm very sure Datuk Jamil is here. We saw the vision of almarhum Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman in setting up this Kuliah. I think the Kuliah was the third Kuliah after the Ahmad Ibrahim Kuliah of Laws and the Kuliah of Economics and Management Sciences, with the hope of integrating the revealed knowledge and the human sciences. So I hope that the Kuliah will continue in this journey. And of course, I know that there are still a lot of challenges. Yesterday, we were talking about integration of knowledge in Kuliah of Education, also during the professorial lecture. So I hope that this integration and Islamization of knowledge in human sciences, I hope that the Kuliah will lead the way and will show the way on how to do this. And hopefully that not only this can be done at the university level, but I think we can go down to the schools, primary school, secondary school, and so on and so forth. Because I think these lectures are integral to our mission of Islamization, integration, relevance, and innovation within the field of revealed knowledge and human sciences. So at the end, again, I would like to extend my congratulations to both of our professors today. And I hope that the Kuliah will organize more professorial lectures. I know that your Kuliah have many professors. So I think we want to learn from your professors. So I hope that the Kuliah will organize more professorial lectures even this year, inshallah. So at the end, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless all our effort and of course grant his pleasure and his paradise. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our university and our ummah. Wabillahi taufiq hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Prof. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, before I invite the first moderator to the floor, let us watch the montage of our first speaker.
لا لا تحسب أن الدين بعيد عن حب وحياة وبهجرك للدين ستحيا تعشق ما قلبك يهوى أو أن الأيام ستحلو وترى الدنيا شط نجاة دينك بحر من آمال شط لجميل الأحلام ليس الدين كما تخشاه ذا ممنوع ذاك حرام فالإسلام جميل حقا هذا ليس هو الإسلام كل أوامره تهدينا وتنادينا للخير ينهانا عن كل طريق يأخذنا نحو الشر والله رحيم وحليم يدعو دوما للبر كل أوامره تهدينا وتنادينا للخير ينهانا عن كل طريق يأخذنا نحو الشر والله رحيم وحليم يدعو دوما للبر صلاة وصيام وكذلك فرح وسرور والمتدين من تلقاه مبتسما حلوا كالنور يسعى ليعمر دنياه وهو رقيق الطبع صبور الإسلام سلام فينا يزرع فينا حب الناس الإسلام سفينة حب يدفعها أجمل إحساس ما أحلى الدنيا لو عشنا وجعلنا الإسلام أساس كل أوامره تهدينا وتنادينا للخير ينهانا عن كل طريق يأخذنا نحو الشر والله رحيم وحليم يدعو دوما للبر كل أوامره تهدينا وتنادينا للخير ينهانا عن كل طريق يأخذنا نحو الشر فالله رحيم وحليم يدعو دوما للبر كل أوامره تهدينا وتنادينا للخير ينهانا عن كل طريق يأخذنا نحو الشر فالله رحيم وحليم يدعو دوما للبر
MashaAllah, very, very impressive indeed. Distinguished ladies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would like to invite the moderator for the first session, Associate Professor Dr. Radwa Binti Abu Bakar.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sadatil hudur al-kiram. يسرني أن أعرف حضراتكم بمحاضرتنا الأولى المتميزة الأستاذة الدكتورة رحمة أحمد الحاج عثمان. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce our first distinguished speaker today, Professor Dr. Rahma Ahmad Haji Osman. She is currently the head of the Scholastic Corpus for Literature and Humanities at the Academy of Professors Malaysia and the Deputy Chairman for the International Islamic Literature League Malaysia. She is also a distinguished senior professor, BK6 Jusabi, of Arabic Literature at the Department of Arabic Language and Literature, Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman Kuliah of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Sciences, International Islamic University, Malaysia, where she has excelled in various academic and administrative roles. She holds a bachelor's degree from the University of Al-Azhar in Egypt, a master's from the University of Jordan, and a PhD from the School of Oriental and African Studies at the University of London. Her illustrious career includes a pivotal tenure as the Director of Education Malaysia Division at the Ministry of Higher Education Malaysia from April 2019 to May 2020. During this period, she made substantial contributions to the internalization of Malaysian higher education, authoring 4 policy papers and spearheading 43 national initiatives. At IIUM, Professor Dr. Rahma broke new ground as the first female deputy rector for research and innovation from July 2017 to August 2018, significantly advancing the university's research agenda. She was also the inaugural female dean of the Kuliah of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Sciences from August 2016 till July 2017. She's also the director of the Institutional and Academic Quality Management Office from February till July 2016, and held several other key positions within the university, each contributing to its strategic development and academic quality. She is currently leads the IIUM Ar-Rahma Flagship 3.0. Professor Dr. Rahma's exceptional achievements have earned her 30 international and national awards for academic, research, and innovation excellence. In 2023 alone, she received the IIUM Murabi Award, the IIUM Insan Sejahtera Award, and the AHAS KIRKHS Leadership Award. Her dedication to e-learning and innovation has been recognized with numerous accolades, reflecting her unwavering commitment to academic excellence. She was recently granted the Most Participative Project IIUM Flagship Award. As an active researcher, Professor Dr. Rahma has completed 38 research projects, secured 9 international grants, and supervised 20 postgraduate students. She holds 5 intellectual properties and has an impressive publication record, authoring 30 books and over 130 peer-reviewed articles and book chapters. Her influence in the field is further evidenced by her service on several international journal editorial boards, underscoring her expertise in literary studies and education. Sadat al-Hudur al-Kiram, تشرف المجلس بدعوة الأستاذة دكتورة رحمة أحمد الحجي عثمان لإلقاء محاضرتها فلتتفضل مشكورة. Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to welcome Professor Dr. Rahma Ahmad Haji Osman to deliver her professional lecture.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Honorable Deputy Rector and Acting Rector, Professor Dr. Ahmad Faris Ismail, Deputy Rector for Responsible Research, Prof. Amir Akramain, our beloved Dean, Professor Dr. Shukran Abdul Rahman, my Abah Tan Sri Professor Syed Hussein Al-Attas, my husband Dr. Usman Jaffa, and all my respected colleagues and my students from all over. Barakallahu fikum for coming to this event. Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed colleagues and honored guests, it is with great pleasure, profound respect and humility that I stand before you today to explore the rich and intricate tapestry woven by theology and poetry in the works of the ulama, our journey titled Divine Inspiration, Poetic Expression, seeks to delve into the sacred confluence where divine revelation meets human creativity, producing a unique and powerful form of expression that has profoundly influenced Islamic thought and culture throughout the centuries. In the vast expanse of Islamic history, poetry has not merely been an art form, but a vital vehicle for conveying the deepest spiritual insights, ethical teachings, and theological reflections. The ulama, the revered scholars and guardians of Islamic knowledge, have frequently turned to poetry to articulate complex theological concepts, inspire the hearts of believers, and communicate the ineffable experiences of divine encounter. This lecture will illuminate how the ulama have employed poetic expression to navigate and elucidate the mysteries of faith. We will examine the works of towering figures such as Imam al-Ghazali, Jalaluddin Rumi, Rabb al-Adawiyya, Sa'di Shirazi, al-Shafi'i, Imam al-Haddad, and others. Each of these luminaries has blended the sacred and the poetic to create works that are intellectually profound and spiritually uplifting. As we delve into their poetry, we will explore the themes such as the nature of Allah, the human condition, the journey of the soul, and the eternal quest for divine love and knowledge. We will see how their verses, rich with metaphors and mystical insights, continue to resonate and inspire, bridging the temporal and the eternal, the human and the divine. Through this exploration, we aim to better understand how these scholars have used the beauty of language to capture the sublime truth of Islam, offering us a glimpse into the divine through the lens of poetic expression. Their works remind us that theology is not only an intellectual pursuit, but also a deeply personal an emotional journey where reason and love, mind and heart, come together in the pursuit of truth. Now, I invite you to join me on this journey through the sacred and the poetic. Let us begin by delving into the transformative power of divine inspiration as reflected in the poetic works of the ulama. The role of divine inspiration in the poetic works of the ulama. From the earliest days of Islam, poetry has been a vital medium for expressing religious devotion, moral guidance, and theological reflection. The ulama, esteemed scholars and religious leaders, have often turned to poetry to convey complex theological concepts and spiritual insights in a form that resonates deeply with the human soul. Our first case study is with Imam Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i, one of the most prominent Islamic scholars and the founder of the Shafi'i School of Thought, was also a renowned poet. His poetry reflects his deep piety, wisdom, and keen insights into the human condition. His verses often provide moral and ethical guidance, emphasizing virtues such as patience, humility, and trust in Allah. His first poetry that I would like to highlight is on contentment and trust in Allah. دَعِ الْأَيَّامَ تَفَعَلُ مَا تَشَاءُ وَطِبْ نَفْسًا إِذَا حَكَمَ الْقَضَاءُ وَلَا تَجْزَعْ لِحَادِثَةِ اللَّيَالِي فَمَا لِحَوَادِثِ الدُّنْيَا بَقَاءُ. Let days do what they will and be content with what fate decrees. Do not despair over the events of nights, for the actions of the world will not last. This poem resonates deeply with us as it echoes the timeless wisdom of surrendering to the divine will. In moments of uncertainty, these verses remind us to maintain faith and trust in Allah's plan, accepting life's challenges with grace and patience. On wisdom and knowledge, Imam Shafi'i says, وَمَنْ يَذُقْ حَلَاوَةَ الْعِلْمِ يُدْرِكُهُ وَمَنْ يَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَرِّ الْجَفَا يَلْقَاهُ لَا تَدَّخِرَنَّ فَتًى إِذَا امْتَطَى الْأَدَبَ وَلَوْ كَانَتِ الْمَعَالِي عَلَى أَكْتَافِ مَنْ شَقَّهُ. Whoever tastes the sweetness of knowledge understands it, and whoever endures the bitterness of perseverance finds it. Do not spare the young man if he seeks menace, even if the heights are on the shoulders of those who strive. This verse speaks to the profound journey of seeking knowledge and wisdom, a journey that requires perseverance and humility. It resonates with our own experiences as scholars, emphasizing the importance of enduring challenges in the pursuit of greater understanding. A third example from Imam Shafi'i on the ephemeral nature of life. Inna lillahi ibad futna taraku ad-dunya wa khafu al-fitana nazaru fiha falamma alimu annaha laysat li hayyin watana ja'aluha lujjatan wattakhadhu salih al-a'mali fiha sufuna. There are wise servants of Allah who have left the world and feared its trials. They looked at it, and when they realized that it is not a place for the living to reside, they made it a sea and took good deeds as their ships in it. Imam Shafi'i's reflection on the transient nature of worldly life encourages a focus on the eternal and the accumulation of good deeds. This resonates with our personal reflections on the fleeting nature of material pursuits and the importance of spiritual growth. A fourth poem from Imam Shafi'i on the value of contentment. رَأَيْتُ الْكَنَاعَةَ رَأْسَ الْغِنَى فَصِرْتُ بِأَذْيَالِهَا مُتَمَسِّكًا فَلَاذَا يَرَانِ عَلَى بَابِهِ وَلَاذَا يَرَانِ بِهِ مُنْهَمِكًا فَصِرْتُ غَنِيًّا بِلَا دِرْهَمٍ أَمُرُّ عَلَى النَّاسِ شِبْهَ مَلِكَ. I saw contentment as the head of wealth, so I clung to its tails. No one sees me at its door, nor does anyone see me engrossed in it. So I became rich without a dirham, passing by like a king. This poem beautifully captures the essence of true wealth as contentment, a principle that resonates deeply in today's consumer-driven society. It reminds us of the peace and richness found in simplicity and gratitude. To deep dive into Shafi'i's lament, let us look at his poem on I complain to my Lord about the shortness of my night. Shakawtu ila waki'in su'a hafzi fa'arshadani ila tarkil ma'asi wa akhbarani bi anna al-ilma nurun wa nurullahi la yuhda li'asi. I complained to my Lord about the shortness of my night, and he guided me to abandon sins. He informed me that knowledge is a light, and the light of Allah is not given to a sinner. This poem reflects Imam Shafi'i's deep realization that sins impede spiritual and intellectual growth, emphasizing the importance of purity and righteousness in acquiring divine knowledge. To understand further the poem, let's look at the core themes and poetic devices. Shafi'i's lament, I complain to my Lord about the shortness of my night, encapsulates a profound spiritual yearning that resonates through the ages. At its core, the poem is a fervent plea for divine connection and an acknowledgement of the human condition caught between the ephemeral world and the eternal. The poet masterfully employs poetic devices to evoke a sense of longing and spiritual desolation. The shortness of the night serves as a potent symbol of the brevity of human life and the fleeting nature of worldly pleasures. It contrasts sharply with the poet's desire for an endless communion with the divine. Historical and cultural context. Ash-Shafi'i lived in a period marked by intellectual and religious ferment. The Abbasid Caliphate had fostered a climate of intellectual inquiry, and Islamic thought was undergoing significant development. The poet's lament can be seen as a reflection of this era, a yearning for spiritual depth amidst the complexities of a rapidly changing world. His work, deeply rooted in Islamic tradition, also anticipates the later development of Sufism, with its emphasis on personal devotion and the quest for union with the divine. Ash-Shafi'i's poetry, including this lament, has had a profound and enduring impact on Islamic thought and spirituality. His emphasis on personal devotion, the longing for divine connection, and the recognition of the human condition as a journey towards spiritual perfection has resonated with countless generations of Muslims. His work has shaped the contours of Islamic mysticism and continues to inspire contemporary practitioners. To fully appreciate the significance of Ash-Shafi'i's lament, it is helpful to compare it with other works of Islamic poetry that explore similar themes. For instance, the poetry of Rumi, a later Sufi mystic, offers a rich tapestry of spiritual longing and divine love. Comparing Ash-Shafi'i's direct and personal style with Rumi's more ecstatic and mystical approach can provide valuable insights into the evolution of Islamic poetry. Theological implications of Ash-Shafi'i's lament. Ash-Shafi'i's poem, with its profound expression of longing for divine connection, carries significant theological implications. Number one, Tawheed. The poem implicitly affirms the Islamic concept of Tawheed, the absolute oneness of Allah. The poet's yearning is directed solely towards Allah without any intermediaries or idols. Number two, Ubudiyyah. The complaint about the shortness of night implies a deep sense of devotion and worship. The poet seeks to maximize the time available for spiritual contemplation and communion with Allah. The third, fana, annihilation. While not explicitly stated, the poem hints at the Sufi concept of fana or the annihilation of the self in Allah. The poet's longing, annihilation of the self in Allah. The poet's longing for a longer night suggests a desire to transcend the ego and become absorbed in the divine. Aishq, number four. The poem reflects a deep-seated love for Allah, a theme central to Islamic mysticism. This love is expressed through the poet's longing and complaint. Impact on later Islamic poetry. Ash-Shafi'i's lament served as a foundational text for subsequent generations of Islamic poets. His exploration of themes such as divine love, longing, and the human condition became a rich vine for later poets to mine. Sufism, the poem's emphasis on personal devotion and the search for spiritual union with Allah aligns closely with the core tenets of Sufism. Later Sufi poets such as Rumi and Attar expanded on these themes, creating a vast corpus of mystical poetry. The love lyric. Ash-Shafi'i's lament, with its passionate outpouring of emotion, influenced the development of the Islamic love lyric. While often associated with earthly love, this poetic form was frequently used to express divine love, drawing inspiration from Ash-Shafi'i's model. Thematic development. Poets after Ash-Shafi'i continued to explore the themes of time, mortality, and the human condition, building upon the foundation laid by his lament. However, they often brought new perspectives and nuances to these themes, reflecting the changing socio-political and intellectual landscape. Ash-Shafi'i's influence can be seen in the works of countless Islamic poets, shaping the course of Islamic literature and spirituality for centuries to come. Our next case study is Rumi. Jalaluddin Muhammad Rumi, better known as Rumi, is perhaps the most celebrated poet in the Islamic world. His poetry, deeply rooted in Sufi mysticism, explores themes of divine love, spiritual yearning, and the quest for union with the divine. His masterpiece, the Mathnawi, is often referred to as the Quran in Persian due to its profound spiritual insights and the theological depth. His poem, the Reed Flute Song, which translates to "listen to the reed as it tells its tale, complaining about separations." Another poem from Rumi on spiritual yearning, which translates to "whoever is far from their source yearns to return to the days of union." Rumi's exploration of spiritual longing and the soul's yearning for reunion with the divine resonates profoundly with anyone who has felt the deep desire for spiritual connection and purpose. His metaphor of the reed flute separated from the reed bed symbolizes the soul's journey back to its divine origin, a theme that personally inspires a deep reflection on our spiritual path. Our third case study on Sa'di Shirazi. Sa'di Shirazi's The Rose Garden Gulistan is renowned for its moral and ethical lessons. His famous lines emphasize human interconnectedness and compassion. On human unity, Shirazi says, as translated, human beings are members of a whole in a creation of one essence and soul. On virtue and conduct, he says, as translated as, if your tree bears the fruit of knowledge, you will bring the celestial sphere under your canopy. Sa'di's verses on human unity and the pursuit of knowledge resonate with the universal values of empathy and continuous learning. These themes remind us of the shared human experience and importance of striving for personal and collective growth. Our fourth case study is Imam al-Haddad. Imam Abdullah bin Alawi al-Haddad, a prominent Sufi scholar and poet, made significant contributions to Islamic literature through his profound spiritual writings. His poetry focuses on themes of divine love, spiritual purification, and the quest for closeness to Allah. Imam al-Haddad's works are known for their deep spiritual insight and eloquent expression. In his poem, Qad Kathani, he says, Qad Kathani Almu Rabbi Min Su'ali Wa Ikhtiyari Fa Du'ai Wa Ibtihali Shahidun Li Biftiqari. My Lord's knowledge suffices me from asking and from my choice. My supplication and my plea are proof of my need. This poem's message of reliance on divine knowledge resonates with our own experiences of seeking guidance and contentment through faith, reminding us of the sufficiency of Allah's wisdom in all aspects of life. In his Qasida and Shi'ar, Anta Nurul Wujud, he says, Anta Nurul Wujud, Anta Ni'amal Amir, Anta Bahrul Wujud wal Ata'il Wafir, كل من في الوجود يسعى لرضاك أنت رب العبيد أنت نعم الأمير. You are the light of existence. You are the best leader. You are the ocean of generosity and abundant giving. Everyone in existence seeks your pleasure. You are the Lord of servants. You are the best leader. The imagery in this poem depicting Allah as the light of existence and the ocean of generosity resonates with the awe-inspiring beauty of divine creation and the boundless mercy of the Creator. A third example on divine love and yearning, he says, إِذَا مَا كُنْتَ لِي عَوْنًا فَلَا خَوْفٌ وَلَا حَزَنٌ أَعُوذُ بِكَ يَا اللَّهُ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا يَضُرُّنِي فليس لي سواك محب وليس لي سوى الدعاء وذكرك يا حبيبي دواء للقلب منع. If you are my aid, then there is no fear, no grief. I seek refuge in you, O Allah, from all that harms me. For I have no beloved other than you and no other call. And your remembrance of, O my beloved, is medicine for the heart. This poem's expression of exclusive love and reliance on Allah resonates with the core Sufi tenet of divine love as the ultimate spiritual pursuit, offering solace and healing to the heart. On spiritual contemplation, Al-Haddad says, Ya Rabbi, kam laka min nafhatin, tu'aidu al-fu'ada ilayka wa habba, tuqarribuni fil ghuyubi ilayka, wa tuzhiru li min jamalika hubba. O Lord, how many of your gifts restore the heart and turn it towards you? They bring me close in hidden ways and reveal to me your beauty's love. Imam al-Haddad's reflection on spiritual gifts and the journey towards divine love resonate with our own contemplations on the subtle blessings and guidance experienced in life. Exploring themes of divine unity, love, spiritual path, and purification in Haddad's poetry, we find that a central tenet of Islamic faith and Sufism, divine unity and love, are profoundly explored in Al-Haddad's poetry. To convey the ineffable nature of divine love, Al-Haddad employed metaphor and simile, imagery, repetition, and symbolism. On theological implications, there is affirmation of Tawheed. His poems reinforce the Islamic belief in the absolute oneness of Allah, Aishq as a path to unity. Divine love is portrayed as the driving force on the spiritual path leading to ultimate union with the divine. And there is fana and baqa, the concepts of annihilation of the self and external existence in Allah. Spiritual path and purification. The spiritual journey as a process of purification and transformation is a recurrent motif in Al-Haddad's poetry. To illustrate the challenges and rewards of the spiritual path, Al-Haddad also used allegory, personification, and contrast. Theological implications are the importance of taqwa, stages of spiritual development, and mujahada, where the challenges faced on the path and the importance of perseverance were highlighted. In general, theological themes in ulama poetry, we found that the poetry of the ulama often reflects key theological themes that are central to Islamic belief. These themes include the nature of Allah. Ulama poetry frequently explores Allah's attributes, his omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence, using vivid imagery and metaphors to convey his majesty and transcendence, as well as his eminence and accessibility. The human condition. Their poetry examines the struggles, hopes, and aspirations of believers, offering guidance on navigating life's trials with faith and trust in Allah's wisdom and mercy. On the afterlife, we find that poetic expressions describe the rewards of paradise and the consequences of hell, encouraging believers to live righteous lives in accordance with Islamic teachings. Historical context and impact. The poetry of the ulama cannot be fully appreciated without considering the historical and cultural context in which it was produced. During the golden age of Islam, poetry was a highly esteemed art form, and the ulama were often at the forefront of literary and intellectual activity. Their works were not only expressions of personal piety, but also tools for teaching and inspiring broader Muslim community. Islamic civilization during this period saw significant advances in science, philosophy, art, and literature. The ulama as scholars and leaders played a crucial role in this cultural flourishing. They were not just theologians, but also poets, scientists, and philosophers who contributed to the rich intellectual and spiritual tapestry of their time. Al-Ghazali, a prominent theologian, jurist, and mystic, made significant contributions to various fields, including theology, philosophy, and Sufism. His seminal work, Ihya Alam al-Din, is a comprehensive guide to Islamic spirituality and ethics. Al-Ghazali's approach to theology was deeply rooted in a desire to reconcile reason with faith, and his writings reflect a profound understanding of the human soul quest for divine truth. One of the distinctive features of Al-Ghazali's work is his use of poetic language to convey complex theological ideas. In his view, poetry was not merely a literary form, but a means of capturing the ineffable aspects of divine experience. For Al-Ghazali, poetry allowed for the expression of emotions and insights that prose could not fully encapsulate. His use of metaphors, allegories, and symbolic language in his writings enabled him to communicate the subtleties of spiritual experience and the mysteries of the divine. Al-Ghazali's use of poetic expression is particularly evident in his writings on Sufism and spirituality. In Al-Munqidh Min Al-Dalal, Al-Ghazali describes his personal spiritual journey and his quest for certainty in matters of faith. Here, he uses vivid metaphors and allegories to convey the transformative nature of spiritual awakening. For example, he likens the process of gaining spiritual insight to the removal of a veil, allowing one to see the reality of things as they truly are. Another notable example is found in Al-Ghazali's Mishkat al-Anwar, where he explores the concept of divine light as a metaphor for knowledge and enlightenment. Al-Ghazali uses poetic language to describe the various levels of perception and understanding, culminating in the highest form of knowledge, which is the direct experience of God's presence. Through these poetic expressions, Al-Ghazali not only communicates theological ideas, but also evokes an emotional response in the reader, drawing them into a deeper engagement with the spiritual truth he represents. Educational, mnemonic device. In poetry was used as a mnemonic device to teach complex theological concepts, making them accessible and memorable. The rhythmic and rhyming structure of poetry made it easier to remember and recite. Imam Ghazali's The Alchemy of Happiness uses poetic verses to explain Sufism principles and the importance of inner purification. Poets like Al-Farabi incorporated poetic verses into their philosophical and theological treatises to illustrate and reinforce key concepts. Al-Farabi's The Philosophy of Illumination conveys the concept of enlightenment through divine illumination. On curriculum integration in madrasas, we found poetry was integral to the curriculum. Students were required to memorize and analyze poems conveying moral values, theological insights, and historical narratives. Saadi Shirazi's The Rose Garden was included in the curriculum for its moral and ethical lessons. Under inspirational, we found poetic expressions of divine love, mysticism, and spiritual longing inspired believers to deepen their faith. Rumi's The Reed Flute Song vividly depicts the soul's yearning for the divine. Poets like Ash-Shafi'i provided moral and ethical guidance through their verses, emphasizing virtues like compassion, justice, and humility. The ulama's poetry served as a means for personal reflection and introspection, sharing their spiritual journeys, struggles, and revelation. Cultural integration. Poetry helped integrate Islamic values and teachings into the broader cultural context, resonating with the artistic and aesthetic sensibilities of the time. Rabal Adawiyah's poetry, such as My Beloved, resonates deeply with the aesthetic and emotional sensibilities of her audience. Interdisciplinary influence, we found that the ulama's poetry often intersected with other disciplines enriching the cultural and intellectual life of the Islamic world. Al-Farabi's contributions to both philosophy and poetry illustrate the harmony between reason and revelation. The universal appeal of ulama poetry transcended cultural and religious boundaries, fostering cross-cultural exchange and mutual understanding. Saadi Shirazi's The Rose Garden has been translated into numerous languages, allowing readers worldwide to access its timeless wisdom. In conclusion, the poetry of the ulama serves as a profound testament to the harmonious interplay between divine inspiration and poetic expression. Through their verses, the ulama have masterfully navigated the complexities of faith, offering a rich tapestry of theological insights, spiritual reflections, and ethical guidance. The works of figures like Rumi, Sa'di Shirazi, Imam al-Haddad, and others illustrate the enduring power of poetry to convey the deepest spiritual truth and inspire profound contemplation. These scholars have used the beauty of language to capture the sublime truth of Islam, providing a glimpse into the divine through the lens of poetic expression. Their poetry does more than articulate complex theological concepts. It engages the heart and mind, encouraging believers to reflect on the nature of Allah, the human condition, and the eternal quest for divine love and knowledge. Personally, these poems resonate with me by offering solace in times of difficulty, reminding me of the importance of trust in divine wisdom, and inspiring a deeper pursuit of spiritual and intellectual growth. The educational, inspirational, and cultural roles of their poetry have left an indelible mark on Islamic thought and literature. As mnemonic devices, teaching tools, and personal reflections, their verses have enriched the intellectual and spiritual lives of countless individuals, including myself. The integration of poetry into the curriculum of madrasas and its use in philosophical and theological treatises demonstrate its vital role in Islamic education and cultural transmission. Moreover, the cross-cultural appeal of ulama poetry fosters mutual understanding and appreciation, allowing a global audience to engage with the profound spiritual insights of Islamic tradition. This universal resonance underscores the relevance and significance of their works in today's world, where the search for meaning is all connection and understanding is as pressing as ever. As we reflect on the contributions of the ulama, we are reminded that theology and poetry are not merely intellectual pursuits, but deeply personal and emotional journeys. Through their poetic expressions, the ulama have bridged the gap between the temporal and the eternal, the human and the divine, guiding us towards a deeper understanding of faith and the sublime. These timeless messages continue to provide guidance, comfort, and inspiration, offering pathways to navigate the complexities of modern life with wisdom and grace. Let us continue to explore and appreciate the rich legacy of ulama poetry, drawing inspiration from their divine insights and poetic mastery to navigate our spiritual journeys. Their works remain a beacon of light, illuminating the path towards a more profound connection with the divine and encouraging us all to seek knowledge, embrace contentment, and cultivate a deeper, more reflective approach to life. Wallahu a'lam bisawab. With that, I end with wabillahi tawfiq wal hidayah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
سيداتي وسادتي الكرام، أقدم جزيل الشكر والامتنان للأستاذة دكتورة رحمة أحمد حجي عثمان على محاضرتها الرائعة. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Rahma Ahmad Haji Osman, for the inspired lecture on exploring the intersection of theology and poetry in the works of the distinguished ulama. I will now hand over the floor to the MC. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you, Dr. Radwa. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, let's watch the next lecture's montage.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We are presenting to you the academic journey of Professor Dr. Asim Shahadah Saleh Ali at the Department of Arabic Language and Literature, International Islamic University, Malaysia, IIUM. He joined the International Islamic University, Malaysia, IIUM on July 30, 1990 as part of the Quranic Division in the Center for Language and Pre-Academic Development, CELPAC. In July 2006, he transitioned to the development of Arabic language and literature in the Kuliah of Islamic Legal Knowledge and Human Sciences. Currently, he is a professor and the head of the Department of Arabic Language and Literature, position he has held since January 2019 and will continue until July 2035. He also served as an external advisor for the Masters and PhD Arabic programs at Al Madina International University, Malaysia until 2024. He is honored to be an international advisor for the editorial boards of Arabic journals in various countries. His academic background includes a PhD in language studies from IIUM, a master's in teaching Arabic for non-native speakers from Sudan, a bachelor in Arabic language and literature from Jordan University, and a diploma in human sciences from IIUM. His research areas cover semiology, psycholinguistics, text linguistics, discourse analysis, and contrastive linguistic studies. We are privileged to introduce a remarkable academic and researcher who has received numerous awards and recognition throughout his illustrious career. In January 2017, he was honored with the Rector's Award for Special Contribution, significantly enhancing IIUM's reputation by contributing to its 5-star rating. Prior to this, he received the IIUM Quality Research Award March 2016 for his outstanding work as an editor, further showcasing his commitment to research excellence. His efforts did not go unnoticed as he was recognized among the top 30 contributors to IIUM's research performance in July 2019. In December 2021, he earned both of the Role Model Award and the Kudwa Awards, underscoring his role as a guiding figure within the university. His remarkable contributions continued into May 2022, when he was listed as one of the top 50 contributors to academic performance at AHAS KRKHS, receiving a Gold Award for being an active researcher. Furthermore, on May 5, 2023, he was recognized as one of the top 30 contributors to academic performance at IIUM. In addition to these accolades, he has made significant contributions to the development of Arabic language courses at the university. Here are some of his key contributions. Notably, he has been instrumental in developing the bachelor's courses in Arabic morphology within the International Islamic University academic program in Malaysia. Additionally, he contributed to the formulation of course descriptions for key bachelor's programs, including semantics and pragmatics and introduction to modern linguistics, both offered in the Department of Arabic Language and Literature for the 2021-2022 academic years. He also worked on the development of the course descriptions for phonology during the same period. Looking ahead, he is actively engaged in developing master's level courses for the 2024-2035 academic year, including advanced applied linguistics, grammatical analysis in Quranic readings, and studies in modern linguistics. That's all. Thank you.
Very inspiring indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite Assistant Professor Dr. Muhammad Ikhwan Abdullah, the moderator for the second lecture.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wa salatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Sadatul hudur al-kiram, yusurruni أن أعرف حضراتكم بمحاضرنا الثاني المتميز القدير الأستاذ عاصم شحادة علي. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would like to introduce our first distinguished speaker today. Professor Dr. Asim Shahada Ali was born in Amman, Jordan in 1961. He completed his Bachelor of Arabic Language and Literature in Jordan University in 1984. He then obtained Master's in Teaching Arabic for Non-Native Speakers in Sudan in 1989-88. He then pursued his study and obtained PhD degree in Arabic Language Studies in IIUM in 2005. He also a holder of Diploma in Human Sciences in IIUM. Among positions held by him were lecturer at the Quranic Division, Center for Language and Pre-Academic Development, CELPAD, International Islamic University, Malaysia from 30th July 1990 until 2006. In July 2006, he joined the Department of Arabic Language and Literature, Kulia of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Science, and now known as Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman, Kulia of Islamic Revealed Knowledge and Human Sciences. He also served as International Conference Advisor in the University of Jordan and the Jordan Technology University. He was a chairperson for four international conferences in Arabic Department at IIUM. Professor Dr. Asim Shahada Ali is currently a professor at the Department of Arabic Language and Literature, International Islamic University, Malaysia. He is also the head of the Department of Arabic Language and Literature from January 2019 until July 2025. He is also the chief editor of Journal of Linguistic and Literary Studies from 2011 until December 2025. Among courses taught by him are modern linguistics, applied linguistics, psycholinguistics, sociolinguistics, teaching Arabic for non-native speakers, issues in morphology and syntax. Professor's research area includes semiology, psycholinguistics, text linguistics, discourse analysis, and linguistic contrastive. Until now, Professor Dr. Asim Shahada Ali has authored more than 45 books, and he has supervised 51 PhD students and 37 master students as of 2024. He was appointed as honorary professor at Jordan University in February 2024. Among awards and recognitions received by our professor are the Best IIUM Journal Award, IIUM Editor-in-Chief Journal of Linguistic and Literary Studies, Top 30 contributors to academic performance at the level of International Islam University in Malaysia, Top 30 contributors to IIM research performance, Qudwah Award Silver, Abdul Hamid Abdul Rahman, Kulia of Abu Sulaiman, Kulia of Islam Rebel Knowledge and Human Science, Golden Award, Gold Award, number 10 at the level of International Islam University in Malaysia, Active Researcher Award, Gold, Active researcher, and so on and so forth. The list goes on. And without further ado, تشرف المجلس بدعوة الأستاذ الدكتور عاصم شحادة علي لإلقاء محاضرته فليتفضل مشكورا. Ladies and gentlemen, that is our professor. This is the time now. I would like to hand over the session to the professor who will be presenting a professorial lecture entitled The Phenomena of Islamization in the Ancient Linguistic Heritage in the Light of Modern Linguistics. Prof, the floor is yours.
Just near. Okay. All right. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وآله وصحبه أجمعين. It is my pleasure to welcome Professor Honorable Deputy Rector Academic and Internationalization Professor أحمد فارس إسماعيل, Respected Dean أحاس عبد الحميد أبو سليمان, كلية of Islamic Knowledge and Human Sciences Professor شكران عبد الحميد, Deputy Dean أحاس كلية of Islamic Knowledge and Human Sciences, Distinguished Guests, Academics, Colleagues, Students, Brothers and Sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My presentation in the title, The Phenomena of Islamization in the Ancient Linguistic Heritage in Light of Modern Linguistics. In Arabic, this title can be مظاهر الأسلمة في التراث اللغوي القديم ومعطيات الألسنية الحديثة. This presentation will take a direction to show or to present the Islamization of linguistics in light of modern linguistics, I mean in Arabic linguistics in light of modern linguistics, and to show how Arabic linguistics must take advantage and benefit from modern linguistics in different areas. And in the same time, I have a definition of Islamization, and this the Islamization must be related to a reading of revelation or cosmic or existence. First, I will ask the study of the Islamization of linguistics indeed be somewhat limited to several reasons or to several aspects. The first reason is focus on the literature. Now, majority studies in Islamization focus on literature. Why? Because much of the scholarly attention in the Islamic intellectual tradition has been centered on literature, philosophy, and theology. This is normal. As a result, linguistic studies might be received the same level of focus of development. This is why we say that study on Islamization of linguistics is little bit. The second factor, the term Islamization really is complex. This is what some scholars mention about the term of the terminology Islamization is complex. In the same time, may lack clarity because it encompasses a variety of meanings, this is one, and interpretation depends on context. The third factor, perception of language rule. Some scholars and thinkers might question the necessity of Islamization of Arabic language, which connected to Holy Quran. How we want to Islamize the language which is related or connected to Holy Quran? And this is why they are far from language and they don't accept the term Islamization of linguistic or Islamization of Arabic language. The fourth point, traditions and innovation, there can be resistance in innovation in linguistic studies if it deviates from established traditions or if it seems to challenge conventional understanding. This can contribute to the limited development of Islamization approaches in linguistics. The result of what I mentioned just now, these factors really contributes to why Islamization of linguistics might be extensively explored or developed as other areas of study within Islamic intellectual traditions. This is the result which I find through why Islamization of linguistics is little bit. Now, we have some conception of concept related to Islamization of linguistics and knowledge. I mentioned some terms or some terminology. We have revelation reading in Arabic, قراءه الوحي, and with creation reading, قراءه الخلق, or we see how some scholars said existence reading or cosmic reading or universe reading with different schools. Also, Islamization can be expressed by a term. Sometimes we can express Islamization with a term rooting or referential. Also, in some books, they mention Islamization as referential, or sometimes they said internationalization, also this mention, or sometimes they said the knowledge of Islam, which means for them Islamization. This I find in many books related to Islamization. Now I will focus on the universe reading and ancient scholars, the Islamization among the ancient Arabs, and the meaning of knowledge. Now, the term Islamization is defined according to literary studies or to in dictionary as a unification of complete civilizational knowledge that enables mankind to fulfill task of succession in earth. The concept of Islamization also can be traced back to its founders, who linked reading revelation with reading creation or existence or universe. This meaning, this linkage, implies that the scientific output of the Islamic nation originates from the guidance of Islam in both content and method. Reading the universe, القراءة الكونية, also we can say, involves encompassing human thought in all its cognitive aspects to that it does not conflict with Islamic principles. This is one of the meaning of Islamization, because when we go to the heritage of Arab scholars and their effort in publishing Arabic language and develop Arabic language, we have to connect this meaning with Islamization of linguistics. Also, it is carried out by the mind, which directs and controls the human senses to receive cognitive extensions. This mind is guided by revelation in areas that surpass its limited ability in knowledge, awareness, and perception. Now we have three terms. Revelation, we have knowledge, al-ma'rifa, awareness, al-wa'i, wa al-idrak. We have al-ma'rifa, al-wa'i, al-idrak. These attempts are related to the hereafter or the world of the unseen. And now it's important for us, when Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman mentioned about Islamization, he mentioned that these perceptions of these concepts is related to hereafter, إلى عالم الغيب, which transcends all worlds of knowledge. Now, the Islamization concept can be expressed in Arabic language with different forms. Some scholars said al-aslama, which is meaning Islamization, or al-islamiyya, which means Islamization. Sometimes they express al-aslama, al-islamiyya, with the word at-ta'sil, and some scholars said at-ta'thil. التأثير means التأصيل, which is rooting. Thinkers show
that this meaning of at-ta'sil, as it encompass knowledge in all fields. This is why they said at-ta'sil or al-ta'thil. At-ta'thil. Thinkers show a greater interest in the human sciences than the applied sciences because human sciences are more susceptible to non-Islamic intellectual influences. For example, in contracts, applied sciences like physics, mathematics, chemistry, engineering, these remain unaffected by thought. Really, when you go to the subject of chemistry, this is not affected by thought that can deviate your thinking or affect in your idea. But this is unaffected by external thoughts. Consequently, most studies on Islamization in the linguistic field focus on literary studies. This is what we find, that majority or more studies on literary, like story, like novel, like prose, like poetry, this focus on Islamization of literary study, not on linguistic study. Because why? Because these topics, which I mentioned just now, are significantly influenced by thought. Because poetry influenced by thought. Prose influenced by thought. Novel and story influenced by thought. But for linguistic or for applied sciences, it's not influenced by thought. Now, the meaning of Islamization, I give more details just to understand. Islamization involves the reformation of human knowledge according to a monotheist universe vision, combining the reading of revelation with the reading of universe. The Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of your Lord who was created. In this moment, when this verse of Quran revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, marked a major turning point in the life and the history of Arabs. Why? Because this leading to the birth of a new civilized role for the Arabic language. Now, a new words in Arabic language is civilized from Jahiliyyah to Islamic concept. So Arab people after that, after Islam, and after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam called for Islam, they express their poetry, their prose, their novel or their story according to Islamic concept. According to Islamic concept, this is why this is the kind of development in Arabic language. Development in Arabic language. In this case, all eliminated by Islamic principles, and this includes the recitation of the Holy Quran and reading of the Honorable Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have touched on some fascinating aspects of Arabic linguistic history, particularly in relation to the Holy Quran. Now, the effort to preserve the Quranic text and ensure its proper recitation is indeed a major motivator behind the development of Arabic grammar. Also, this is stage how Arab develop grammars to the need of Muslims who converted from Muslims who are non-native speakers. When they converted to Islam and they need to recite Quran, they make many errors and many mistakes. And for example, the rules established to avoid solecism. Solecism is a word related to al-lahn. Al-lahn means errors, language error. And this happened in the time of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib and Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. And also in the time of ulama after Ali, Sayyidina Ali, like Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. I can mention some narration riwaya about Umar, about Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali and Ali. For example, just I mentioned as Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali, when he heard a Bedouin read the verse of Quran, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأذان من الله ورسوله إلى الناس يوم الحج الأكبر أن الله بريء من المشركين ورسوله. Now أبو الأسود hear this Bedouin read ورسوله. According to Arabic grammar, ورسوله is a noun in genitive case. What many genitive case? يعني اسم مجرور. But in the reading or recitation of this verse, إن الله بريء من المشركين ورسوله. رسوله means in the meaning of this verse that a declaration from Allah and His Messenger to mankind in the great day, which is the month of Dhul Hijjah, that Allah is from obligation to mushrikeen. Now, this is the meaning. When they read wa rasulihi, this mean will be the meaning of this verse. Allah is far obligation to mushrikeen and his messenger. When you read wa rasulihi, but if we read wa rasuluhu, there will be and so is his messenger is far obligation to mushrikeen. This is what make Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali establish grammars to teach non-native speakers for those who converted to Islam from Iran, from I think from Pharisee and from Rum. This is why the riwayat or the narration related to Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. And we have also one story from Sayyidina Umar when he was watching those soldiers in throwing arrows, but they couldn't they are not good training. And he was angry from them, and they told him in Arabic, "Inna qawmun muta'allimin." Inna, we soldiers, and you as a new student. In Arabic, "Inna qawmun muta'allimin" is solecism, yani mistake in grammar, because "muta'allimin" is sound masculine plural. In Arabic, "jam mudhakkar salim." The case of sound masculine plural, when it is in the case of nominative in Arabic, marfu, because this muta'allimun is adjective for the qawm, and the qawm is in the position of the end case is in statement or comment, khabar. Inna is topic or subject. This is why Sayyidina Umar said, خطأكم, your solecism or your mistake is أشد علي, is more affected on me more than your mistake in throwing arrows. This is why the beginning of establishing grammars for none or for Muslims to recite Holy Quran correctly. The preservation of Quranic text and the reinforcement of Arabic's rule as a sacred and prestigious language were central to these efforts. Now, our statement seems to address the need to renewing. Now, according to what I mentioned, our statement seems to address the need for renewing linguistic studies in the context of Islamic thought and contemporary needs. The traditional approaches to ancient linguistic need, now this is what I mentioned, need modernization to address issue that have emerged over time also to point out the problems of text plagiarism. Also, we have text plagiarism in the ancient books. They mention many many texts, but without any reference. Also, we have to mention that. And rigidness in the Arabic language, and advocate for a more dynamic approach that integrates variable aspects of ancient heritage with contemporary linguistic. To summarize, modernization of linguistic, there is a need to update linguistic studies to its contemporary context and need while respecting Islamic principles. This is a need. A second, historical challenges. Ancient linguistic methods have issues such as unorganized text, plagiarism, and rigid structures which need to be addressed. Third, renewal and development. Linguistic studies should evolve, recognizing that what was effective in the past may be not be applicable today. This is logic. Now, this is the idea which I want to focus in my study. Now, we have the influence of Arabic linguistic studies in Western. Now, this also is important to know how Arabic linguistic heritage affected on the Orientalist movement and how they take advantage from Arab scholars or from grammarians. For example, we have Robin in his book, History of Linguistic, where he mentioned only two pages about the heritage of Arab in grammar. He mentioned only two pages. When we go to another book for Birgit Strasser, German scholar, he has a book in Arabic, التطور النحوي للغة العربية, the grammatical development of the Arabic language. In this book, Birgit Strasser explores the historical evolution of Arabic grammar, providing insights that have informed comparative linguistic studies. Also, we look to the scholar Johann Fick, in his book Al Arabiya. This is an Arabic book, Al Arabiya, دراسات في اللغة واللهجات والأساليب. In this book, he delves into the diversity of Arabic dialects and linguistic style, offering a comprehensive analysis that enriches the understanding of language variation and change. These scholars, what they do? They bridged the gap. Now we talk about these scholars. They bridged the gap between Eastern and Western, I mean heritage and Western traditions, showcasing the universal nature of linguistic inquiry and the enduring impact of early Arab linguists. And briefly, the early stages of Western linguistic, the early stage of Western scholarship in linguistic was notably influenced by Arabic linguistic studies. Scholars like, for example, Robin, and Birgit Strasser, Fick, and Jonathan Oyn. He has a book also in the tradition of Arabic. Also, we have Bouhaas. He has a book of the tradition of Arabic linguistics. Those have highlighted the impact of Arabic linguists on the development of grammar and linguistic theory. And this is important to know that those Western scholars or linguists affected from Sibawi and others. Despite this, many historians of linguistics have overlooked the foundational contribution of prominent Arab scholars such as Sibawi, Al-Farra, Al-Jahid, Abd al-Qahir Jurjani in his book, Dalail al-Ijaz, and those play a significant role of development of linguistic research. And I will say what I mentioned, this is reality, the Western take from those scholars in their theories in describe language, to describe language, especially when they describe English, also affected from Arab scholars. To highlight, it highlights the differences. Now I will look now of the meaning of Islamization, which related to development. The word development is related to Islamization. Now we have the effort of Arab linguists in the past and what they do in Arabic language and how they develop Arabic language, and this considered as Islamization of linguistics. It highlights, I mean, the image up, this image highlights the differences between ancient contemporary approaches to linguistic research. I summary this. Ancient Arabic scholarship focus on understanding language through reasons and causes. This is the theory, السببية والماهية. This is the methodology of Arab scholars. Contemporary linguistic research prioritizes empirical observation and analysis, often separates linguistic level. Now, Arab scholars in the past, they did not separate between level of languages. We have phonetics, morphology, syntax, and semantics. But for Western scholars, they separate. This is the difference between Arab scholars and contemporary linguists. I go to now a second stage, the development of Arabic linguistic studies, particularly highlight the influence of Arabic grammarians on Western scholars and the evolution of linguistic methodology. First, influence on Western scholars. Arabic grammarians significantly influence Western scholars, as mentioned just now, in the study of sounds. Yes, they take from Sibawi, because if you read the book of Robin, the principles of Sibawi al-Kitab, this is PhD thesis for Robbins in University of London. He talked about Sibawi and divided the book of Al-Kitab for three topics, morphology, rhetorical studies, and syntax. And this is the book in English language and was written in 1961. I mean, this PhD thesis. Significant influence in sounds, grammar, and structure. Key works like Sibawi, Al-Kitab, and Al-Khalil ibn Ahmad in his book Al-Ain were central for this influence. We have a stage of language collection. Now we have language collection is also important for Islamization of linguistics and codification. We call it al-ihtijaj al-lughawi in Arabic, al-ihtijaj al-lughawi, or jam' al-lugha, jam' al-lugha. This stage is important to relate Islamization with the effort of Arab scholars in linguistics. Collection and interpretation of Arabic vocabularies without systematic arrangement relied heavily on linguistic argumentation. Sources of vocabulary. Now, what happened and what Arab do to collect vocabularies and to issue books about that? For example, the sources of vocabulary was first this take from Holy Quran and prophetic hadith. Maybe prophetic hadith, we have different view of points. Some of grammarians rejected prophetic hadith. Why? Because they said it's not riwayat tawatur. So we cannot say this is from prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi. And some they accept. According to Sibawi, he accept. Scholars they don't accept, but in general they accept these prophetic of hadith as a resource for Arabic language. Also, we have ancient Arabic literature and oral tradition of the Bedouins, example of vocabulary collected, and we have the book of Abu Zayd al-Ansari, and he collects in the language, which meaning in Arabic, النوادر في اللغة, where he collects all poetry from the era of al-Jahiliyyah. And he take from al-Imam al-Asma'i. And he take this poetry from al-Imam al-Asma'i. This is the development of Arabic language according of Islamization of linguistics. Third stage related to history of linguistic theory, particularly focusing on the view of early scholars like Al-Khalil and Ahmad and Ibn Jinni. Al-Khalil ibn Ahmad in his work represents an early systematic approach to the Arabic language by cataloging vocabulary through permutation and combination. Permutation meaning arrangement. Combination, and he laid the groundwork of a methodological study of language that reflects deep awareness of linguistic structural semantics. Methodology of ancient Arabic scholars, they employed a comprehensive methodology that combined transmission, oral traditions, intellectual reasoning, criteria, comparative analysis, and integrating approaches. This holistic view contributed to the foundational understanding of Arabic linguistics. Also, this we have to admit with this truth. Now, the origin of human language. Now we have many theory according to Arabic heritage and according to Western scholars. In general, we have this school, Orthodox dogmatism, and this was that language originated from revelation or divine inspiration. ما يسمى in Arabic الوحي والإلهام. الوحي is inspiration, الوحي, الإلهام, revelation, الوحي. This theory, Ibn Jinni, in his book, Al-Khasais, he said, proposed by that who argued that language is a product of instruction or learned behavior rather than a divine gift. I explain. We have three schools, our three doctrine in the origin of a human language. First, we have the first one suggest, I mean, the origin that أن اللغة أن أصل اللغة وحي. أصل اللغة وحي. Meaning the origin of the language is reveal or revelation. This suggests that language was divinely revealed according to perspective Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who inspired Adam alayhi salam. What to do? The ability to name things. وعلم آدم الأسماء كلها. This is the first theory or first doctrine. The second doctrine is the theory proposed that language developed as a social construct influenced by the interaction and humility among people. This also, this theory was said by Ibn Jinni. اللغة توقيف واصطلاح. توقيف واصطلاح. And this like this theory or this doctrine we accept is the correct theory because we cannot say language is a revelation because we have different languages and we have no proof that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create language for each nation. We have no evidence in the history until what mentioned about Arabic language in all a narration in hadith that the language of Arabic is the language of Quran, of Jannah, all a hadith da'ifa, unacceptable. Only ulama just create this narration. When you look to this narration, all are a weak narration, not unacceptable from scholars. But you know, emotional, we want to show that Arabic is the language of Quran, the language of Paradise, Jannah. This is maybe, we say maybe, but we cannot say this is, we sure about this fact. We cannot sure because there is no evidence from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, no evidence. Now we look for the kind of imitation and simulation, which is mentioned by Ibn Jinni also, and he said that according to this perspective, language emerged from human mimicking the sounds of their natural environment. And this posits that language evolved from the imitation of nature sound. This is the theory of Ibn Jinni. In his book, Al-Khasa'is, he said that in the chapter, Amsasul Al-Fadi Ashbahul Ma'ani, the touches of words like meanings, he explores the idea that individual sounds carry inherent moral or expressive meanings. This theory suggests that the origin of language are rooted in natural sound. Now he mentioned and he give us the natural sound, like, for example, the rumbling of wind, of the wind, we call it in Arabic, dawi, the rumbling of the wind. And we have haninur ra'd, the nostalgia of thunder. Why? Because the deep resonant sounds of thunder could have inspired words association with powerful booming noises. And we have the murmuring of water, kharir al-ma, kharir al-ma. This is what Ibn Jinni mentioned. But this, if you want to this, we analyze this theory, this is limited language, because this words is limited. You cannot say language of a human being from this origin. We go to the Western. Western, we have five schools. First, Noam Chomsky theory, when he talk about universal grammar, and he talk about innately, I mean, al-fitra, the human being create language according to his innately, and also he create universal grammars. And we have, for example, in Malay, when I say saya makan nasi lima, in Arabic, I say ana akul al-lugha al-arabiya. This is now universal grammar. We have subject, verb, object. This is universal grammar. Verb, subject, object, object, verb, subject, according to the languages. Some languages are the same, or agree with each other, and some languages is differ. This is why we call it universal grammar. This is the theory of Noam Chomsky. Now we go to evolutionary theory. We have four schools. The first school is Bowen theory, which suggests that this language evolved from animal sounds. This from animal sound. The second, Poh theory, this proposed that language evolved from involuntary vocalization like cries, sighs, and grooms. This is second theory. Third theory, Ding Dong theory, this suggests that early human languages developed from onomatopoeia. Onomatopoeia is a Greek term, means the nature of sounds, أو باللغة العربية الأصوات الطبيعية. Onomatopoeia, الأصوات الطبيعية. And we have the fourth theory, Yu He Ho theory. Yeah, this is theory famous from the scholar Edward Burnett Taylor. And this is very good theory. Why? Related to life. This theory related to our life, to our what activity in life. If I allowed to me to read what is it, according to this theory, early human languages developed from examinations used during manual labor tasks. This is the idea. During our life, what we do. For example, rowing boats and hauling logs. This is, so what happened for this? The people will go to examination and they will express their life according to these sounds. The exclamations would eventually evolve into more complex grammatical structure as a human began using them for other activities such as storytelling. And this is the point, storytelling. Now, just allow to me to comment on this, that theory I have discussed just now address different aspects of language origin and development. Theory of revelation, theory links the origin of language to divine or spiritual liberation, and it suggests that language and creation are intertwined, with revelation providing fundamental guide to understanding language emergence. And we have instruction or humility al-lugha tawadu wa tawqif. Also we have al-lugha hiya wahin wa ilham aw tawadu. This, let me go to another topic. I don't know time. How much I have time? 2 minutes? So in this case, I have to go, because I have many topics really related to systemization of linguistics, and I can approve that we have many problems with the contemporary challenges for the teachers, for the teaching of Arabic topics in linguistics, in phonetics, because we have a lack, for example, of laboratories. For example, when scholars from engineering, we use artificial intelligence to use computer and to use Arabic words, how to use this Arabic words in computer, and we need scholars from linguistic studies. This is the idea which we have challenges. And also, if I can just read in this case, and also I mentioned about differences between philology and linguistic and how Arab in the ancient era, they did not differentiate between philology and linguistic. They don't differentiate. And also they mix between the level of language, which is phonology, which is phonetics, phonetics, morphology, morphology, syntax, or grammars, and semantics. They mix. They don't differentiate, but for contemporary linguists, they differentiate. They read each level separated from another level. Thus, I go to the conclusion which I want to mention, that the developed modern Arabic linguistics, while effectively linking to the ancient linguist insights, several strategies, we have many strategies to develop this study as the following. We have many ideas. For example, scientific routing and avoiding false problems. We have second, historical contextualization, a new evaluative method, integrative comparison, lead tools for describing Arabic. We have many. And we have organization, descriptive and interpretive tools. We have building authentic and modern linguistics. Really, we have many ideas to present. Maybe the time doesn't allow me to present more, but just I end with the name of Arab scholars in nowadays who contribute really. They contribute to Arabic linguistics and they integrate, or they try to take benefit from contemporary linguists from Western, and they applied this science or this ilmu on Arabic linguistic. For example, Abdel Qadir Al-Fasi Al-Fahri from Morocco. We have Abdel Salam Al-Masaddi from Tunisia. He is from Tunis, and he has a book about 300 pages and more, just talk about the origin of human language. Imagine 300 pages, talk about the origin of a human language. He mentioned the heritage and mentioned what contemporary was talk about and why, and he suggests a new strategy to understand the human language. We have Tamam Hassan. Mr. Tamam Hassan, he is famous for all scholars in Arabic language who contribute to, and he tried to change the arrangement or permutation of Arabic grammar. And he focused on the theory of al-qara'in, al, yani contextual text. When he read about grammar, morphology. We go and Ahmed Mutawakkil, he is famous in his theory, functional grammar, النحو الوظيفي, where he focus on what Ferdinand de Saussure said when we talk about language. Language, it has three levels: language of society, standard language, and individual language. And he used the term Lalag. Lalag is mean individual language. This referred that each one can express his idea, his emotion in different ways, and this will be grammatically. For according to his theory, functional grammar, this is grammatically. Yani it's not follow the Arabic grammar, but follow the word which can be according to permutation or word order. Maybe you put the word at the beginning, but you mean something else. This is what we call it, functional grammar created by Al-Mutawakkil. This is Karim Hussein Al-Khalidi from Iraq. And this is Abd al-Rahman Al-Haj Saleh, this famous from Algeria. He has many contribution in Arabic language, and he has a project. Now the end is Nihad al-Musa. I think our departments and our colleagues, majority study under Professor, Allah yirham, Professor Nihad al-Musa. I studied with him in 1981, the subject of morphology. But when he teach us morphology, we read from Sibawi, you know, from Sibawi and Lisan al-Arab. Really, he give us a new method of teaching how to understand this different derivation, you know, derivation ishtiqaq for the word, and how you can apply in your life. This is what the idea of Nihad al-Musa. I hope you take benefit from my idea, and I hope I present my direction about summarization of linguistics. And maybe I didn't mention for you what should be done to Arab linguists nowadays to take benefit from Western. We have to take in different aspects, and I have a proof that we have to take from them. In the same time, this to show that integration between Islamic or from Arabic heritage in linguistic with contemporary linguistic, or you can say modern linguistic. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
شكرا جزيلا الأستاذ الدكتور عاصم شحادة علي على المحاضرة الرائعة، وقد تطرق إلى ظاهرة أسلمة التراث العربي في ضوء اللسانيات الحديثة. Thank you very much Professor عاصم شحادة علي for the inspired lecture as he delved into the aspects of Islamization and relevantization of ancient linguistic heritage in the light of modern linguists. I will now hand over the floor to the MC. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you, Doctor. This marks the end of our inaugural professorial lecture. I would now like to invite Professor Dr. Ahmad Faris Ismail, accompanied by Professor Dr. Shukran Abdul Rahman, to present the souvenirs to our speakers and moderators. Firstly, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Rahma Ahmad Haji Osman. Next, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Asim Shahadeh Saleh Ali. Thank you, Prof. Next, our moderators for today, Associate Professor Dr. Radwa Abu Bakar. Next, Assistant Professor Dr. Muhammad Ikhwan Abdullah. And thank you very much, Prof. Faris, as well as Prof. Shukran. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, may I now invite Assistant Professor Dr. Muhammad Anwar bin Ahmad to recite the closing dua.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، واغفر لنا إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم. اللهم إنا نسألك سلامة في الدين، وعافية في الجسد، وزيادة في العلم، وبركة في الرزق، وتوبة قبل الموت، ورحمة عند الموت، ومغفرة بعد الموت. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في ديننا ودنيانا وأهلنا وأموالنا. اللهم آتي نفوسنا تقواها وزكها، أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع، ومن قلب لا يخشع، ومن نفس لا تشبع، ومن دعوة لا يستجاب له. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا، ورزقا طيبا، وعملا متقبلا. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن، ونعوذ بك من العجز والكسل، ونعوذ بك من الجبن والبخل، ونعوذ بك من غلبة الدين وقهر الرجال. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مباركا مرحوما، واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا شقيا ولا محروما. O Allah, we seek refuge in you from knowledge which is not beneficial, and from a heart which does not fear you, and from desire which is not satisfied, and from prayer which is not answered. O Allah, we ask you for beneficial knowledge, good provision, and accepted deeds. O Allah, we seek refuge in you from worry and grief. We seek refuge in you from incapacity and laziness. We seek refuge in you from cowardice and stinginess. And we seek refuge in you from the burden of debt and the oppression of men. O Allah, make our gathering a blessed and merciful gathering. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، استغفرك وأتوب إليك.
شكرا جزيلا دكتور. الحمد لله. We have come to the end of the program. On behalf of the organizing committee, we would like to convey our greatest appreciation to our honorable guests and to all our audience today, physically as well as virtually. We also wish to express our sincere gratitude and special thanks to those who have contributed directly or indirectly in making this event a success. May all your good deeds be blessed and rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. I would now like to invite everyone for a photography session. And the first photo will be taken from in front here. So everybody just look at the photographer. Okay, maybe our guests from the sides can move to the middle.